You know, one of the reasons that Jesus told us in John chapter 10 that he is the gate of the sheep. Think about this for a second. The door to life, or the gate, that everyone would go through him would be saved and go in and out and find green pastures, because he is the only one. It's not to be found any other way. All who came before him, he says, were thieves and robbers. But he said this, I've come that you may have life and have it abundantly, or have it to the full. Now, we're either going to take Christ at his word and believe that and put him absolutely at the center of our lives and begin to experience the things that God's telling us that he will give us, or we're going to keep on stiff-arming him. That's an act of will on our part, what we choose to do with that.
Abounding in Faith is the broadcast ministry of Emmanuel Bible Church of Howell, New Jersey. If you are blessed by this message, please subscribe to our podcast or YouTube channel. You can also download our app by searching for IBCNJ in the Google Play Store or the Apple Store. For more information, please visit us at www.ibcnj.org. Our speaker today is Senior Pastor Joe Suozzo.
Blessed are those who mourn, Scripture says, for they will be comforted. Such a strange combination of words from our Lord Jesus Christ. We don't usually associate blessing and happiness with mourning and suffering. We typically associate happiness and joy with things going well. And yet here Christ is putting something in front of us that should cause us to pause and think. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. What is the Lord really talking about here? He's telling us that something common to the human experience that we all share, and that is, life is not what it should be. We all share that. When we look at ourselves, we realize that we fall short in so many different ways. We look at the world around us, we realize that things are not quite what we want them to be. And so there's all kinds of directions this fallen world that's wrecked with sin and evil and injustice and imperfection, there's several directions we can go with that. One of those directions is to try to resolve things on our own terms. And so we go around in circles and don't really get much traction with that. Another way we can try to resolve things is to turn towards others, government, relationships, even church. We think that it's somehow found here. No, again. The Lord is really saying to us is, if we're going to be comforted, our comfort in this world that's broken is to be found in God and God alone. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. We're in our second week in our series on the Sermon on the Mount, Christ's longest teaching, in Matthew chapter 5 through 7. And in the first verses of this sermon, Christ unveils to us what are called eight beatitudes. Beatitudes, these are qualities that's speaking about the inner life. Beatitude, the word beatitude comes from the Latin we were sharing last week, meaning happy. And really the Greek translation of blessed here has the idea of both happiness and a sense of well-being attached to it. And so Christ is saying, this is what the happy attitude looks like. And he's going to give us eight principles which become the undergirding attitudes of our heart in the Lord that lead to the blessed life. And that's how he begins the sermon. And from that point on, he's going to tell us what then the overflow of the attitudes of our heart are going to mean in terms of our behavior. And he's going to get into areas like anger and sexual purity and the way we handle money and worry and all those things, the outer life. But before we deal with the outer life, we have to ask ourselves, what's going inside us? Why sometimes can we be so miserable? I don't know about you, but I can tend to drift towards misery at times, my heart and soul. And it's important for us to ask ourselves, why? Why is it that way? And what does the Lord have to say about it? And so we have these wonderful Beatitudes. Last week we looked at, blessed are those who are poor in spirit. And that's foundational to our relationship with the Lord, because he's basically saying that only when we acknowledge our poverty without him, which is really another definition of humility, our poverty without him, that it's going to lead to a blessing, because now we're inviting him in. You see, there's this great football player, by the way, I was watching the other day, and I don't get football anymore because I only live stream, and the NFL really closed things out, so I'm kind of disappointed, but I just kind of threw it away. But I do like watching football. I grew up with my father watching this guy. What a stiff arm. This guy's just blocking and stiff-arming people and just running down the field, and they're just, he keeps on just knocking them away. You know, that's the way some people are with the Lord. They're stiff-arming him. God wants to be involved. He's running with us. He's going along with us. No, I got it. I got it. Keep on pushing him away, pushing him away. And then we wonder why we're so miserable inside. Because the very fount of our happiness, the very fount of the one who can bless us, the one who can give us a sense of joy and purpose and hope for the future, we're doing this to God all along because we're trying to do things in our own strength. Well, Christ is saying, blessed are those who are poor in spirit. I can't do it. I can't do it, Lord. I turn to you, for theirs is the kingdom of God. And now he moves on to this wonderful second beatitude. Blessed are those who mourn. You know, one of the reasons that Jesus told us in John chapter 10 that he is the gate of the sheep. Think about this for a second. The door to life, or the gate, that everyone would go through him would be saved and go in and out and find green pastures, because he is the only one. It's not to be found any other way. All who came before him, he says, were thieves and robbers. But he said this, I've come that you may have life and have it abundantly, or have it to the full. Now, we're either going to take Christ at his word and believe that and put him absolutely at the center of our lives and begin to experience the things that God's telling us that he will give us, or we're going to keep on stiff-arming him. That's an act of will on our part, what we choose to do with that. And so we must be humble. Now, when Jesus talks about blessed are those who mourn in Matthew chapter 5, verse 4, and, you know, here's how great God's word is. I could preach a three-week series just on that one verse. But I'm going to keep things moving along. We're going to nail it on this one. But I want us to see something very, very, very important to our souls. Jesus is trying to help us see that to receive the fullness of life and the comfort and the healing he alone can give, we must grieve and mourn our brokenness without him. We must come to a place of deep sorrow in ourselves for what we are in the world around us. Our brokenness and sin can lead us really in one of two directions, and we see this in the hearts of people around us. First, it can lead us to work things out without God at the center. We have a culture that's gone off the rails in this direction. That means we place the burden of change and healing on ourselves or others for relief, maybe religion, self-help. there's so many ways that people are rushing headlong to find relief for the sorrow that we're all feeling because of a world that has fallen and sin sick. And it's like a merry-go-round. We just never come to the end of it. Around and around and around, and people are not finding the fullness of life. Our struggle with our own brokenness and sin can even bring us to point our finger at God. I've talked to someone recently who's saying that. I saw it not too long ago, even on an interview in the news. And we see the brokenness of the world around us, and we point our finger at God and say, why did you allow it to be that way? Well, might as well blame someone instead of looking at ourselves. In this interview at CNN, it was a woman by the name of Deborah Mitchell, and she argued that she would not bring God into her family. And she said this, how could a loving God allow murder, disease, and war? So, God's fault, let's keep him out, stiff arm him out. And I felt sad for this person because the very fount of life is inviting her in and she's stiffing arming him out. And that's the way our culture is. But Christ is inviting us to another way, an attitude and response to sin and brokenness, and that's to turn to God for help. And when we talk about repentance, by the way, fancy word for simple meaning. Repentance simply means to turn from myself, to turn from this world, and to turn to God alone. We're going to explore that a little bit. It has to include a sense of grief. That's what mourning is, a sense of grief for the way I am at times and the world around me is. And this repentance, this mourning, will ultimately lead us to seek God alone, for forgiveness, healing, and the comfort we need. And so Jesus teaches us, blessed are those who mourn, for there they will be comforted. And of course, the comfort he's talking about is from God himself, his word. So this morning, we're going to look at just two aspects of grief and brokenness. You say, man, this is the right sermon for the right day. Gloomy, rainy, dark. And here Pastor Joe's talking about suffering and mourning and gloominess. So the Lord sent me this nice rainy day just to accentuate the point, right? So two things about grief and brokenness. First, we begin with ourselves. We share this one thing in common. There's something within us that desperately needs repair. We sense that there's something terribly wrong within us. Paul expressed this, by the way, in Romans 7:15, when he says, I don't understand my own actions. Think about this. This is from the Apostle Paul. I don't even understand why I do this sometimes. Why am I so self-destructive? Why do I point myself away from God? For I do not do what I want. I do the very thing I hate. A few verses later in Romans 7, he says, wretched man that I am, who will save me? Who will deliver me? See, Paul's being honest about what we all face. I don't like myself at times. I don't know if I'm alone here. You're saying, I hope I'm not alone here, because if you're not sensing this, I'm not sure you're fully in touch with who you really are. The second aspect of brokenness we'll look at this morning is our response to the world around us. Again, we all share what I call the misery of the human predicament, conflict and dysfunction in families. You're saying, check. Poverty, racism, sickness, evil, injustice, crime, the list goes on and on. You know, it is amazing to me, those who regularly diet on talk radio or the news, they all share one thing in common. They're hopping mad at the world. I'm not sure that's what God wants us to be doing. I think God wants us not to be angry at the injustice, but to be vehicles of peace to the world around us. But that's another discussion. There's a godly reaction. There's an ungodly reaction. A godly reaction is going to bring comfort from the Lord. Ultimately, in our struggle with a broken world, we call to God for help and we're comforted. An ungodly reaction is one that ultimately stiff arms God and becomes filled with anger, bitterness, judgment at our failures or the failures of others around us. And our world is so filled with angry, bitter people, is it not? God's inviting us to another way. Several times this week, I don't know if it's this week, but several times this week, I pull out on West Farms Road about the same time, maybe a little bit after a guy's pulling out across the street. He didn't like that. He guns it and comes up like 3 feet behind my rear end. Now, also I had these imaginations like Arnold Schwarzenegger saying, I'm going to pull over and blow this guy out of the water. I like all of a sudden so angry at this situation. I just pulled it to the side of the road and I just had to pray for myself, my reaction. But I thought to myself, what? Really? And then a couple other times this week on Route 9, people are cutting me off and doing some crazy things. Just, I don't know what it is about this particular week, but it just seems there's a lot of angry people out there. And maybe they think they're invincible in their cars or whatever. It's called what? Road rage. Road rage. Anyway, let's look at these two aspects. Grief at our own brokenness, grief at the world around us. Let's start with those who respond without God. Those who, they see the brokenness within them and they're responding now without God. We see several ways people can respond to brokenness without God. One is we can lie to ourselves and tell us things are all not all that bad. You know, there's this T-shirt that became popular a few years ago. Life is good. A big smiley face. You're going to not like me for this statement, but something in me wanted to smack somebody who's wearing that T-shirt. You're saying, Pastor Joe, I didn't like that T-shirt because it's not tied to reality of the pain that I experience. I listen to people who are struggling every day. We look at the news and we see terrible things going on every day. My heart's in mourning. I want, like, Lord, we need your help with an unhappy face, right? So that he is the one who's going to bring the comfort and the solutions we need. And yet our world is kind of trying to convince itself things are good. No, they're not good. That's why Jesus came, because they're not good. That's why we need a Savior, because they're not good. God tells us in the book of Jeremiah 17:9, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. People are telling themselves all kinds of things that are not real, ignoring sin that's within us. Isaiah 5:20, we read this, woe to them that call evil good and good evil, that put darkness for light and light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. What's God really saying? He wants us to be real about what we're experiencing. He wants us to be without hypocrisy. He wants us to be truthful to him so that ultimately our happiness, our comfort, our sense of well-being does not come from the world, does not come from my own self-effort, but ultimately comes from God Most High, who created the heavens and the earth. Now, I'm not saying we shouldn't develop a positive attitude. That's not what I'm saying here. I do think we need to think positive thoughts based on the Word of God, by the way, not based on just niceties. How do we do that? We look to the Scripture. We remind ourselves that God is able. We remind ourselves that God is good. We remind ourselves that God is loving. We remind ourselves that God has given us eternal life. We remind ourselves that God is the resurrection and the life. We remind ourselves we have a glorious future. There's the comfort. And then we begin to live out that truth from God's word, and we become a positive people. We become a joy-filled people despite the world and the craziness around us. Another ungodly reaction to our brokenness is religion. This is what Jesus was faced with, especially surrounded by Pharisees, teachers of the law. If you remember a few weeks ago, we talked about this in the Sermon on the Mount, how one of the audiences around him were the Pharisees. And he says, unless your righteousness surpasses theirs, you'll by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. That's in the Sermon on the Mount, chapter 5, verse 20. Religion. Religion really is man's effort to reach God on his own terms, in his own power, in his own way. Is church enough? No. Meditating enough? Meet those who are caught up into New Age, you know, sit down and have your meditation practices. I was caught up in that for a while. Giving enough? Simply trying to reach God on our own? Our focus here is not God when we do that. Our focus is ourselves and our own works. It's really what I call distraction from the battle that's going on within us that can only be resolved, as we're going to see, through the cross of Christ. Micah, the prophet, said this in chapter 6, just to remind us the vanity of religion. He rebuked Israel for their self-righteousness. He said this, with what shall we come to the Lord with or bow down before God Most High? Shall I bring a burnt offering or a calf year old? Will the Lord be satisfied with 1,000 bulls or 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I give even the fruit from my own body? And the answer, of course, is no. All your religion is empty before me. I want reality, God says, to do justice, to love kindness, to walk humbly with your God. It was a rebuke that religion is not enough. The difference between religion and biblical faith is this. Religion seeks God on its own effort, while authentic faith trusts God for what he's spoken in his word and his son, the person of Jesus Christ. That's true faith. Listen to how 1 Peter 2:14 expresses this. He says this, he, that's Christ, bore our sins in his body that we might die to sin and live unto righteousness, for it is by his wounds we are saved. We don't heal ourselves. He's the healer. You know, there's another way I've seen, which I also was caught up in. It's exercise movement or health movement. And we should exercise. We should take care of ourselves. Not saying don't do that. But remember what Paul said to us in 1 Timothy. Little exercise is of some value, but godliness is of value in every way, because it holds promise for not only this life, but also the life to come. What I experience, and I see so many, is when we're in our 30s and 40s, we're exercising like there's reckless abandon. I was, you know, training for these mini triathlons and all these weird things when I was in my 30s and 40s, like biking. Deep down, what's going on is I don't want to age. I think I'm going to mitigate the aging process. And all of a sudden, you get to your 50s and things start breaking and muscles start pulling and disc herniations and all kinds of weird things, you know, and now all of a sudden you have to change. You know, I know there are exceptions, and the media is always putting these great exceptions out there. For generally speaking now, most of us in our 50s are going to start breaking in some way. By the time we get to 60s and 70s, we're talking about tummy tucks and knee replacements and hip replacements and all kinds of things. But at the depth of all these things, if you think about it, is this aging process we don't like. Now, here's what I think God's word is asking us to do. We need to mourn it. I lament the dying process. But at that point of lamentation, I celebrate resurrection. So what is greater, the resurrection or the lamentation of aging? I'll tell you what God's word says. Where, O death, is your sting? Where, O death, is your victory? Thanks be to God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who gives victory, you see, because now my hope, my strength is the Lord and his promises of a forever future. You see, now I'm comforted in my aging process. I talk to so many who are just really lamenting it, and I'm used to be one of them. So Paul asks the question, what wretched man am I? Who will deliver me from this body of death? And that, of course, leads us to a godly response. Thanks be to God, who gives victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, a godly response to our brokenness always is going to lead to one simple word we were talking about before, is repentance. Repentance means to turn from ourselves, to turn to Christ. When Jesus is telling us, blessed are those who mourn, he's telling us that our happiness begins with a deep conviction about our sinful state and how miserable we are without God. One of my favorite tombstones is William Carey, who was one of the greatest. He's called the father of modern missions, went to India at the turn of the 18th century, was there until he was 92 years old, and he passed. He did some amazing things, established a university, won many to Christ, translated the Bible into multiple languages. Guy was incredible. He was a simple shoe cobbler, by the way. He wrote this on his tombstone at the end. Oh, but a hapless worm am I. On thy kind arms I fall. What was he saying at the end of his life? Hapless worm, that's not a very nice picture of humanity, is it? But that's really our state. On thy kind words I fall. That really demands from each of us to ask ourselves the question, where am I looking for my comfort in this life? Where am I looking for my strength? Where am I looking for my hope? Am I looking to myself? Am I looking to others? Am I looking to government? Am I looking to politicians? Or am I turning to the Lord? You see, that's what repentance is, to turn from the miserable condition, my sinful, broken state that I'm in, my rebellious state against the Lord, to turn to God, who through Christ sent him to be what is called a sacrifice, a propitiation for my sin, that through him I may be healed. You see, by his wounds we're healed. That is a great promise of Scripture, isn't it? By his wounds we are healed. If our sorrow and grief lead us to God, we discover that God, in his great wisdom, and uses all that brokenness to teach us, grow us, change us, all that to be the people. And in that we find comfort, don't we? He's the God who works all things for the good. So we look to ourselves. We need to see ourselves for what we are: broken, weak, sinners. But then in Christ, an amazing miracle happens. We receive the fullness of life. And when you have Christ, it's you in Christ. Guess what? That equals 100%. When it's you and you, you're in the minus category, my friend. Where it's you and the world, minus, deficit. But in Christ, you have all the fullness of what God has promised. You can't add to it. Think about that. So we begin with ourselves. The second thing we have to grieve is the world around us. How do we react to the world around us? If you're like me, I love some of those movies. They're so stupid, though, aren't they? You know, the Terminator. But they all have one thing in common: instant justice. you know, that someone has the power to right a terrible situation. And we like that kind of thing because we want the world to be right. And it kind of sings to our heart, those kinds of movies. You know, but the problem is, it doesn't work. That justice is only really satisfied by God himself. And so how do we see a world of brokenness? Let's kind of explore some of these reactions by the world around us without God. A few weeks ago, there was a YouTube video that had gone viral. An Indian shop owner, Sikh, I believe it was in California, had a thief come into his store with a 50-gallon trash can, and he begins to unload and empty the shelves of various things, very expensive things like cigarettes and what have you. And while he's doing this, the Indian shop owner is trying to tell him, no, you shouldn't be doing this. And he says, don't worry, you're going to have to claim this on your insurance. There's nothing you can do about it. Well, he disappears in the video, and a couple minutes later, he and his brother come out with what in India is called a lathi. It's a stick, a long bamboo stick, and they start beating this guy. And he crawls up into a ball, and they beat him, and eventually the police come and arrest him. And do you know that that is the most popular YouTube video of the year? Millions of views. Why did we like to watch something like that? Because we saw justice served in this sin-sick world. But really, that's really not where our heart should be. What about this poor guy? I know what you're thinking. This poor guy who's a thief, what brought him to the place that he thought that this was a good way to live? What a horrible way to live, to try to steal your way to provide when there's a God who's promised you to provide everything you need. Isn't that a better way to live, to trust in God? So our hearts should be broken for the whole scene, for the shop owner, for the thief. You see, there's a godly reaction. You think Jesus would get out a stick and start beating the thief? Remember the two thieves on the cross? Christ extended mercy. He extended invitation to eternal life. You see, we have to look at our way we're reacting to the world. When somebody cuts me off on the road, do I want to be like Arnold Schwarzenegger and get out the gun and go, poof? Obliviate them from this life. Or I'm thinking to myself, I think the godly reaction is, man, what puts a person in such an anxious, angry state that they're willing to risk their life and weave in and out of traffic like an idiot? So we have to look at our reactions to things. Another ungodly response to the brokenness of the world around us is to turn to politicians and government. We got another election cycle going on. Come on, you've lived long enough to know that this thing goes around and around and around. I do pray that we have the right people who can put in good policy to make our lives better. Don't get me wrong, I think we need to pray for it. I think we need to vote for it. I'm not suggesting to withdraw from the political process. But what I am saying is, let's not believe that our ultimate hope rests in the political process. That's all I'm saying. That ultimately, we have to put our trust in the Lord. And actually, the founding fathers said this in so many different ways. They didn't believe that the political process was the end all. It was a transcendent God that would bring justice and human rights. Listen to the warning that God gave through the prophet Jeremiah when people turn to man for help. Woe to those who trust in man, who make man their strength, flesh their strength, who turn their hearts from the Lord. And then he describes what that kind of person is. They're like a shrub planted in the wilderness. They'll not see anything good come. They're like a barren plant in the wastelands, the salt lands. It's a description of what happens when we're trusting in man and not God. And then there's another response, is simply to escape from all the sorrow and of the world around us. Run away. Run away. Get out of town. Right? problem with that is it's you can't run from a world that's fallen. It's going to find you. The aging process, your own thoughts and struggles, and you run from here to there, and guess what's there? It might be there, you're there, which is part of the problem, but something else is there that's part of the problem. You know, the parable, and I'll finish with this, the parable of the prodigal son in Luke 15 is an excellent example of a son who believed that what he really needed was to escape the responsibility of his father's estate. Whatever was going on there, it's just a parable. I don't want to read too much into that part of it, but really, what would motivate somebody to leave their responsibilities, take their inheritance early? He goes, takes it, he parties hardy. We know the story. He parties hardy, he has a blast, and he spends all his money. And he winds up in a pigsty, hungry, destitute. And what's interesting about the parable to me is that he somehow believed that the happiness was out there without God, that the abundant life could be apart from God. Doesn't work. I think that's one of the lessons of the parable. We can't escape responsibility and sorrow and sin. There's only one recourse for it, and we have to run back to God the Father. In Him only we can find the fullness of life. And so the parable frames out several responses in this young man's heart to God. I mean, he discovers the blessed life, but how does it go? I love it. It begins with repentance. It begins by waking up to the reality of the way things are. Listen to the way Christ describes this young man in Luke 15, verse 17. When he came to himself, that's what I'm talking about here. Wake up. Come to yourself. See yourself for what you really are. Sinner, destitute without God, miserable, all those things, dying, aging. The list goes on. There's a lot about this world, a lot about ourselves we don't like. And we have to come to ourselves about it. That's the reality of it. He comes to himself, and then he says this, I'll rise and I'll go to my father. And I'll say to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. I love what happens next. He gathers courage to go back to his father, broken, humiliated, repentance. Blessed are those who mourn, you see. And he goes back to the father, not sure whether he'd be accepted. But he knew enough about the character of the father to know that the father is merciful. And I love when the son rises, goes back to his father. And then the parable says this, listen, he was still a long way off. His father saw him and felt compassion, love, and ran and embraced him, kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. And the father calls his household together, employees together, holds a great banquet to celebrate his lost son. And listen to what the father said. This is my son who was dead and is alive. He's lost. Now he's found. And they began to celebrate. That's the story, should be the story of each of our hearts. dead in our sin, transgressions. But now through Christ and his sacrifice, we are made alive, given new life. Lost, trying to find satisfaction in the world or in ourselves, doesn't work. But in Christ found. See, that's the essence of the gospel right there. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Father, thank you for your word and your path. For the path of the righteous is like the first gleam of dawn, shining brighter and brighter until the full light of day. Thank you, Lord, that as we turn to you, we discover all the riches of Christ in the heavenly places. That's your promise to us, Lord. Help us to see things the way they really are and to find the comfort that's only to be had in you. In Christ's name, amen.
Thank you for listening to the previous message. We pray that you were blessed by it. For more information, please visit us at www.ibcnj.org.